All right, this is the Innovation Technology Forum. 4 years ago in Atlanta, at the suggestion of Vision Internet founder Steve Chapin, 3CMA launched the first Innovation Technology Forum. The members and staff and sponsors realized the growing importance of technology. However, at that time, we didn't fully appreciate the impact of Facebook, Twitter, and other social media avenues would have on our work as communicators. Today, we are fortunate to have Kristy Dalton, the CEO and founder of Government Social Media, to talk about what's hot now in government social media, and Crystal Patterson, God willing, isn't here yet, but I know she's on her way. She's the Government and Politics Outreach Manager for Facebook, and she's going to talk about utilizing Facebook beyond the like. But I'd now like to introduce Ashley Freesting. She is the Director of Sales from Vision Internet and the sponsor of today's Innovation Technology Forum.
Good morning. Good morning. I know over the years you all have come to expect that we would do some kind of video, but this year we decided to bring in some outside talent. So if you'll bear with me for just a second, we'll get this rolling, and for your viewing pleasure.
First things first, I'm the realest.
Realest.
Drop this and let the whole world feel it.
Let them feel it.
And I'm still in the murder business. I can hold you down like I'm giving lessons in physics.
Right, right.
You should want a bad dude like this.
Huh?
Drop it low and pick it up just like this.
Yeah.
Cup of Ace, cup of Goose, cup of Chris. I heal something worth a half a ticket on my wrist.
On my wrist.
Taking all the liquor straight. Never chase that.
Never.
Stop like we bring an 88 back.
What?
Bring the hooks in where the bass at. Champagne spilling, you should taste that.
Good to be back with you all. I realized as I was putting this together, and of course having fun with a lot of friends here, that this is my seventh consecutive 3CMA conference, and it's exciting to just to see how many new faces are here. Did I hear there are 100 first-time attendees? That's awesome. Steve and I were actually talking about, because he had been a part of the very first 3CMA conference where sponsors were involved, and it's just incredible to see the growth of this organization, and good to see everybody connecting. So as, of course, there are changes with 3CMA, with new faces and new things, you might have heard that there are also some new changes at Vision Internet, including our new CEO, David Nachman, who I wanted to introduce. Of course, course, Steve Chapin is still going to be very largely involved in our company, and we look forward to using this investment, this new leadership, to better serve our clients, provide new services in terms of how you're going to manage your websites and the things that you're going to do. We also recognize that the growth that we're experiencing is so much about the people that are in this room. Our clients who have supported us over the years, have been there for us, have provided suggestions for new things that we can develop and the things that they would like to see. And we thank you so much for the support that you've given us. And again, just look forward to moving into the future and continuing to provide more. So. With that, it's my pleasure to introduce the Innovation Technology Forum. We have a great day planned with Kristy Fafelski and I guess Kristy Dalton. I forget. Yes, Kristy Dalton, who recently got married. an old friend, of course, from her years in Reno as a client as well, so it's always good to see her. And then, of course, with Facebook. So, again, a great day planned, and we look forward to sharing it with you. Thank you.
I wanted to call you Fafelski too, but I did it right. Kristy Dalton is the CEO of Government Social Media, where she trains public sector agencies on using social media to engage citizens. She served in local government herself for over 10 years in roles ranging from government web management to public relations. Kristy was recently the new media director for eRepublic, where she led social media strategy for industry magazines such as Government Technology, Governing, and Emergency Management. You may recognize Kristy as GovGirl, the host and creator of the popular GovGirl.com online video show, where she highlights government innovation. Kristy Dalton.
Well, hi there. Hi. I just need a moment to set up my laptop here, so I figured I'd ask you a question. By the way, thanks, Ashley, for getting that song in my head. I hate that song. So who is the most annoying personality on social media that just makes you annoyed with social media? So what I'm asking is it the oversharing cousin? You know, we all have one of those. Who is it? Just shout it out. Your sister. Well, the food shares, you guys that take a picture of every meal that you think looks so fancy and you post that on social, that's not fun for everyone else who doesn't have that lovely meal in front of them. You know, my personal most annoying person type on social media is the "does this need stitches" guy. Do you have that guy in your life too? It's like, yes, go to the doctor. I don't want to see that. Actually, it had nothing to do with anything, but I needed to buy some time here. So, here we go. Actually, my family is the perfect illustration of the different types of personalities and familiarity levels with technology that we have. In the social space. How many of you have ever seen a GovGirl video? Some of you, oh, that's awesome. Well, you probably came last year and I showed one, so anyway. If you've seen a GovGirl video, you notice that every once in a while I am able to rope my mom into being in a video. And my mom is actually currently temporarily living with us until she dies. Well, she's not sick or anything. She just doesn't really seem to have a game plan for getting out of the house. At any rate, she's made it to a couple of videos, and we're working on her with technology and her comfort level, and she's progressing. She's progressed a lot over the last year. We got her an email account, and we set up her Facebook page, and she's trying
to learn. Oh, and just recently, we got her to learn how to open up the text messages so that she can see more than just appears right on the screen as the alert. So I had to previously make some really short text messages from her. And I swear this is a true story. She drove me to the airport so I could come here. And I sent her a text and said, you know, thanks, Mom, for driving me, and got in plenty of time for my flight. And she sent a text back, which I was pretty impressed with. And last night in my hotel room, she calls me up and says, oh, she doesn't call them texts. She calls them my little messages. She's like, so I got your little message, and I wanted to say I'm sorry I left off an R, so I didn't want you to think that I said you welcome. Thanks, Mom. I was pretty concerned about that. At any rate, she's learning. But in government, we have so many of these different comfort levels with technology, these different personality types on social media. And so when we use social media for our agencies, it's very difficult to adapt to all of the different types. And you might be one of those roles yourself and have an interesting time adjusting. A few months ago, I spoke at a NATO social media summit in Sarajevo, and one of the things that I learned is that other countries really recognize the United States as a leader in social media in terms of government using social media to connect with citizens. Now, the agencies that I was there with, these were progressive agencies, but globally, there's still this fear of getting on social media and of opening yourselves up to citizens. And, you know, sometimes we see illustrations of the reasons why. For instance, NYPD recently, or a couple of months back, they tweeted, do you have a photo with a member of the NYPD? Tweet us and tag it with hashtag MyNYPD. It may be featured on our Facebook page, but at any rate, and they showed a photo here. And it started off going well, where people were replying with some photos of, you know, positive moments of their interaction with police officers, and then it turned dramatically negative. And the hashtag began to be used by people who were sharing photos of unfortunate situations with police officers, where things, where it looked like citizens were being beaten by police, and all these unfortunate circumstances. Now, what we think is that they weren't actually showing pictures of themselves in this situation, but they were finding pictures on the internet and hijacking this hashtag and using it. And so this became known within the last few months as a negative example of putting yourself out there on social media. And the conversation surrounded, well, should they have foreseen that something like this might have happened? And I was more interested in their response to what happened, because it was widely reported that this was a fail, basically that this was a fail. And what I think is that their response is actually the best under the circumstances that they could have done. Now, they didn't apologize and say, you know, we're sorry for putting ourselves out there and for trying this. Instead, they said, the NYPD is creating new ways to communicate effectively with the community. Twitter provides an open forum for an uncensored exchange, and this is an open dialogue good for our city. I thought that was a pretty good response under the circumstances. They didn't apologize, and they recognized that, you know, you can say whatever you want here, and it's probably good for us to listen to what you're saying. You know, in the, you know, in the situation in Ferguson, with the intense scrutiny of police and the community and the protests and the looting and just that really tense situation in Ferguson over the last month. During the height of that, we also saw the impact of social media in one instance in breaking that really harsh tension. And that was because at Huffington Post reporter posted or tweeted, I believe these are rubber bullets. Can anyone confirm? #Ferguson. Of course, he spelled that incorrectly. He was being completely serious. That's the thing. This, you might not be able to see this picture very well, but these are not rubber bullets. They are, in fact, earplugs. He tweeted this picture, and this is, again, in the midst of the protests, at the really heightened point. And even though he didn't intend this at all, people started responding, sort of a break, a levity in the moment of intense despair all around. I like this tweet. I believe this is a taser. Can Ryan Riley confirm? Everybody in response really started getting into it. And I like this one. I think I found evidence of chemical warfare. And then, of course, it became a hashtag. Hashtag, can anyone confirm? And it just took off. After that point, it got turned into an internet meme with a photo. I think I found a landmine. Can anyone confirm? Sometimes we need that power that social media can offer. And through my experience working with directly within government and working within government social media at a time where we're just launching the profiles, we're figuring out what is this thing, and then fast forwarding to today when we're seeing some pretty sophisticated social media techniques used by government agencies. And then in my involvement with Government Technology Magazine and really seeing what's hot across the country, and through my current company, Government Social Media, I get the privilege of hearing examples of just outstanding social media efforts across the country. So I thought what I'd share with you today is, based on my observations, I'm looking at what's really hot in social media in government right now, or what's just hot in general, and I think we should really harness this and apply it to government. What I'm really starting to see is an acceptance of social media by government agencies, and I don't just mean this in a general sense, I mean this literally. Pretty frequent judge of competitions, particularly website competitions. Back in the day, I helped my friend Chris Matthews, not the famous Chris Matthews, but I helped him judge Savvy Awards when 3CMA was in the, I believe, in the Lake Tahoe area. And I've judged NAGWA, the National Association of Government Web Professionals Pinnacle Awards, in the past. And when I've judged in the past, I've noticed that they're focused strictly on websites. There was a mention in the applications for these contests. There was a mention of, yes, we're on Facebook and Twitter. But fast forward to today, as I'm involved in judging these competitions. By the way, if anyone ever asks you to be a judge for a competition and they say it'll only take a couple of hours, it's a bold-faced lie. It doesn't. It takes a lot more time than that. At any rate, I have found that social media is now an integral part of their web and their digital presence and their e-government. And they go into backstories talking about how they have support from leadership, they have support from the mayor, and they're figuring out how to make this all happen. I'm seeing a lot more integration directly within websites, not just putting the Twitter icon there, but using the Twitter API and having a mega menu on a website that pulls in the feed related to the particular menu item that you selected. I've seen a lot of sophistication there. And we also have a lot of data now. We know that recently by the International Association of Chiefs of Police that law enforcement agencies, about 96, just shy of 96% of them, are on social media. They have social media profiles. They're actively using social media. And we just got data from the Center for Digital Government looking at state government social media use. And it looks like about 90% of the states are really utilizing social media as well. So I'm noticing this trend. I'm happy with this. Another trend I'm noticing, I think this is really hot right now. Embrace it for all you can. And that is that social media is turning into experiences rather than fleeting moments. So whereas before we would shoot off a tweet about a particular program or post something on Facebook or maybe an Instagram photo, now it's a coordinated effort where we turn it into something that's much, much longer than just that one brief activity. How many of you have watched this video? This was a viral video from a few months ago. Tara the Hero Cat. Have you heard about this? Okay, so this was in, I believe, Bakersfield, California. There was a little boy who was just minding his own business, riding his tricycle outside of his home, and a neighbor's dog actually came up to him and attacked him and pulled him off the tricycle. It's kind of hard to watch for a brief moment until you see what happens, and I'm just going to show you this little video clip. There's no audio here. This was captured by the home security cameras. You see the neighbor dog coming up and just grabs the kid, totally unprovoked, pulls him off. Kids, okay, but here comes Tara the Hero Cat. Chases the dog away after she drop kicks him. Now, my cat would not do this at all. Mine would be sitting on the porch. Cat comes back to make sure that the kid is okay after he chased off the dog. Now, what happened after this, the boy actually, he had a pretty substantial injury on his leg, and he got it stitched up, and he's doing fine just now. But what happened with the support of Tara the Hero Cat after that just went, it went totally viral, and it was pretty phenomenal. This was just this one brief moment, but they turned it into this experience. Tara the Hero Cat has a Facebook page. Tara the Hero Cat has a Twitter profile. Tara also has a Google Plus page. Tara the Hero Cat has an online store where you can buy an adult onesie. This is true. And ultimately, Tara the Hero Cat actually threw out the first pitch at a local baseball game. This is true. Watch the video from that. To be honest, it was a little weird. At any rate, they extended it to become this entire experience. And you know, part of that was to sell Tara the Hero Cat merchandise in their shop. But if you check out those profiles today, I like what they've done with it. They've turned it, the family has turned it into promotion of adopting pets from the Humane Society. And they've turned it into promoting instances of pets doing these really superhero things. So they've turned it into something kind of cool. And in government, we see this happening with they would be standalone tweets, but instead we're turning them into let's have the chief do a tweet along or a virtual ride along. Let's extend that experience. Let's get more interaction. Let's get more out of it. I'm also seeing something that's really hot right now. I love this trend, and I want everyone to embrace it because it's close to my heart, and I love it, and that is the use of humor on social media. Perfect platform for this, and I'm actually starting to see, even over the last year, more and more government agencies embracing the use of humor on social media. I mean, for instance, the CIA. Remember a few months back, their very first tweet? We can neither confirm nor deny that this is our first tweet. This was, in fact, their first tweet, I think. But if the CIA can do it, so can we. They're probably the one organization, the government entity in the United States that has the most reason for secrecy. Their entire purview is related to secrecy in some way. Now, another thing that I'm seeing as a particular agency, actually law enforcement, is really embracing humor on social media, and it completely goes against everything I would expect, because you would expect police, fire service to be very by the book, very formal, and in some circumstances they are, but in others, they're just totally rocking it on social media. For instance, someone sent a tweet to a police account. They said, "You want to buy some weed? I do good prices," you know, because people are smart. And This police department replied with, "No thanks. Nice to know you do good prices, though. Our investigators are always looking to speak with people trafficking drugs." Or how about this one's one of my favorites. Another police department arrested a 28-year-old man today for stealing a Twilight Saga DVD box set. Store owners suggested making him watch it as punishment. Love that one. And, you know, beware of what the police department posts. You never can believe what you read. Unless, of course, they indicate that it's not a scam. The police says, not a scam. If you've committed a burglary in the area within the last week, come to our police station and claim a free iPad. Not quite sure I would trust them. Something else that's really hot is just the sophistication of platforms nowadays. So if you, for your city or your county, you set up social media profiles, 5 years ago, even 3 years ago, even last year when I spoke here at 3CMA, so much has changed with multiple platforms along the way. And it's very interesting. And the way that cities and counties are embracing those platforms are getting more sophisticated as well. You know, last year when we would talk about Pinterest, we'd talk about, well, you know, we know that Pinterest is a great platform, you know, with women. We know it's a great platform in terms of sharing photos, but how do we really embrace this and what do we do with it? And, you know, we're finding, particularly in law enforcement, that they're finding ways to really utilize Pinterest in terms of strategically making things happen and getting things done. For instance, they're using it to post most wanted photos or missing photos. They're using it to post, and this has been pretty successful, as lost and found photos. Although I don't quite get how the lost and found photos work, because I'd be like, yeah, I have a purse that's missing. It's got four little buckle things on the side. I can totally describe it to you. I can show you a picture, actually. It's right there. Don't quite get that. But in terms of the platform sophistication, let me just break it down a little bit and talk about what's new with these platforms that I think as government we should be taking a second look at. First of all, let's talk briefly about Facebook. And, you know, the new timeline layout is not that much of a change as it was before, but I think the most significant change between now and last year when I spoke with you is just the real big focus on ads. Of course, the newsfeed algorithm changes as well, but in terms of ads, I think a lot of government agencies aren't even looking at what could we do with ads because they're thinking, well, we're government. A, we don't have money for ads. B, nobody wants to see our government agencies' ads. It's just weird. That's for private industry. That's for, you know, commercial. But I think where you can benefit from considering ads is that ads not only promote your Facebook page. Maybe you don't want to really promote your Facebook page because that's not where all the action happens. All the action happens over on your .gov or your .org, whatever your website is. Nowadays with Facebook ads, you can create an ad and promote, bypass your Facebook page altogether and just promote what you want to promote on your own site. You can do this now. You can get pretty sophisticated in terms of taking your current audience and promoting content just for them. So you can use Facebook as a tool for instance, you can put a tracking pixel on your website and you can collect information about people that visit your official government website. Now you're not tracking sensitive information like credit card info or social security numbers or anything that's personally identifying, but you can track that their browser has visited your website before or that their browser has visited your website for a particular program on your website. And I would certainly, being government, I would add this to your privacy policy that this is something that you would be doing from now on. I think that that's important. But you can basically collect this information and you can do different things in Facebook in terms of the ads. You can target the people who have gone to your website recently. you can use your email list. If you have an email list, from GovDelivery or a Constant Contact or a MailChimp, and you have that data, you have the email addresses as a CSV file, you can import that into Facebook. You can create a custom audience where you can target your specific content to them. So a lot of the email programs like a GovDelivery, they can segment out the lists so that you have people, say, who just signed up for parks and recreation information. So you take those email addresses within Facebook, you make a custom audience, and with that custom audience, you use that particular audience to just promote your parks, your park programs. And if you want to be more particularly focused, promote those programs which are going to earn you revenue some way, because people are going to a particular activity at the park that is accepting a registration fee or something like that. So you can be pretty sophisticated with Facebook, and that's one of the things I'm interested to see how governments harness that in terms of what's available to you. Let's switch gears and talk a little bit about Twitter. I think Twitter has some of the most interesting platform updates over the last year. So they did a refresh of the look of your profile page, and that you probably know. And if you don't know that, go check your social media accounts and make sure that you have it optimized for the new look of the cover photo style in your profile picture. However, Twitter introduced their ads platform as well. And I know I'm talking a lot about ads, but you don't even have to use the ad part. Just go to ads.twitter.com, and you can find that you can do some different things that you can't do just on regular twitter.com. For instance, natively, you can schedule your posts through ads.twitter.com instead of going to a Hootsuite or third-party management services. You can schedule them natively. And you can also create some pretty sophisticated campaigns within this ads platform. And you can publish these campaigns just as though they're regular tweets. They don't have to be promoted tweets where you're putting any money towards it at all. But you can track the success of your campaigns. So you would use a campaign for something like an annual State of the City address, right? So your mayor, your elected officials are going to participate in the State of the City address, and you want to do some promo materials before that. You pre-prepare your tweets, you schedule them, you associate it with a part of that campaign, and then it's an easy way just to track the effectiveness of that campaign, because you can see how many times your tweet showed up in the timeline of others. You can see how many times your link was clicked on, and you can see basically the reach of your tweets in relationship to this campaign. And these are a lot of the things that we're trying to figure out how to do on our own. Why not use the platforms as they come out with these new features? I could talk about Twitter all day. You can do these things called Twitter cards, where you can actually collect an email directly from Twitter to add to your lists, so to your government lists. You can do so many different things. Let's switch gears and talk a little bit about LinkedIn. LinkedIn, over the last year, has had some interesting changes. They're doing really, really well. They're a publicly traded company. They're doing very well. They have now become known as a publishing platform. How many of you are on LinkedIn? You have your own personal profile on LinkedIn. I will expect you all to connect with me after this. You can find me, Kristy Dalton. At any rate, it's become more of just let's connect with each other on LinkedIn. It has become let's use this as a personal publishing tool. So you already know that you can publish a little update on LinkedIn, but now you can actually publish something longer. It's more like a blog post. Well, why would you want to publish it on LinkedIn as opposed to maybe you have your own professional blog, or you might have a communication that's blog-like or a specific blog within your government website? Why post it on LinkedIn? Well, LinkedIn is going to get you a ton of views. Everything that I've published as an article, as a post on LinkedIn, has gotten so much more traffic than coming in from other locations. And this is because LinkedIn is going to share it with your contacts, and they're going to get you a lot more traffic. So even aside from what you're doing within your agencies, take a look at LinkedIn, give it a second look in terms of what can I do with this professionally, how can I connect with my peers, but more so, how can I be seen as a thought leader on a particular subject that I'm really focusing in on in my agency, and I'm going to start posting on LinkedIn as a publishing platform. I'm probably most fascinated in the changes over the last year to YouTube, however, and that is because I like video. I like posting these videos. If you go to youtube.com/govgirlblog, you can find my series of videos on here. And YouTube natively has launched different features that make it so much easier to work with YouTube. So how many of you are in like a media communications type shop? You work with video production or with the people who work on video production? Okay, so you guys are my people right here. So a lot of probably what you're involved in terms of YouTube is figuring out ways to quickly get these videos that you've already produced for some other medium, for a government channel or something like that. You've produced these videos for another medium. How do you quickly, you know, slice this up into little bite-sized chunks, put them on YouTube because, you know you should put them on YouTube so they get more viewership because everything's going to digital tiers and nobody's really getting the local channels anymore, so let's utilize YouTube. Does that sound right in a nutshell, a little bit? Well, I really like the tools that YouTube has nowadays. For instance, before we used to take those videos, we would have our intro and we would have our outro, and in Adobe Premiere or Final Cut Pro or Camtasia or whatever you're using, you'd have to slap those on each individual videos, then upload it. But now you can do this within YouTube, and you can apply things like this to multiple videos. You can bulk select videos and apply various features to it. One of the things I like is, here's a screenshot of a recent GovGirl video and a couple of different enhancements that I added to this very, very quickly that I'd like to see you do with your government channels, is in the upper right-hand corner, you can have a bug. You can have a little icon that you don't have to add this as an overlay to your videos anymore. You can instead add this as a little graphic representation of your video channel. And I would recommend that you do something like the same thing that you have as your profile picture or something like that. And when the user rolls over that, they see a pop-up that says how many subscribers you have. I'm already subscribed to this channel, so that's what you see here. If I wasn't subscribed, it would have a subscription button. And as a user, I could click on that and I wouldn't have to go anywhere else. So they've made it very, very simple for you to get more subscribers to your channel, and more subscribers is what you want to happen. You can also do a video over another video. I know I'm talking for a long time here. I don't see the other speaker. If you see her at any point, just cut me off, but I figured that, you know, I'll just keep talking with you. Sound good? Good, cool. And if she doesn't come, I'll tell you what I really feel about Facebook. Just kidding. I do support the fact that we can really embrace the changes in government if we do it strategically, and we can talk about that more as well. But at any rate, with YouTube, you can do a picture on a picture type thing where your video is playing, and at a certain point in the video, another video that you select pops up at the bottom and encourages people to watch that. And you can have it display for a certain period of time. You can have it pop in at a certain point. You can have it just be set to your last video. So it really, really supports having people subscribe to your channel, having them watch more videos. The changes in YouTube has been pretty interesting over the last year. So they're not so much looking at video views when they decide whether or not your video shows up in different locations, like in search results and in suggested videos and in other places in YouTube. They're not so much looking at, does this video have 500 views versus 10 views? Instead, they're looking more at how long are people watching that video. This is the stat that they're using. So it's important that you have videos that represent the thumbnail pictures accurately, they're titled accurately, because what you want to happen, you don't want that link bait type idea. What you want to happen is that people click on your video and they get exactly what they're looking for, so they're going to watch it throughout. And then your channel's going to be more successful because you'll show up in more search results, you'll show up in more recommended related videos, and so forth. So definitely like the changes within the YouTube platform. Another thing I'm seeing that's pretty hot in terms of government is using social media for situational awareness. I just love this image here. In case of fire, exit building before tweeting about it. Makes a lot of sense, but it's common sense. So social media for situational awareness, it's the idea that if we pay attention to what's happening on social media in terms of Facebook posts, in terms of tweets, in terms of Instagram photos, we can get a better understanding of what's going on the ground, in particular situations where it's important. If there's an emergency in the area, there's a particular issue, we can monitor social media and get a better idea of what's happening. So situational awareness has a few different factors relating to it. We're seeing a lot of, this isn't a new term for social media, emergency managers or for law enforcement, but they're now starting to apply it to social media and they're really realizing the benefits. If there's a gas leak in your community and you're performing situational awareness, and so you understand that over on this block, there's all these tweets from people saying they don't smell a thing, they don't see a gas leak, and hopefully it's an odorous gas or else that's not gonna tell you much at all. But then on the next street over, you find that there is a lot of activity, a lot of tweets. Well, it just gives you eyes on the ground if you didn't have people on the ground, and you can, you don't wanna take everything as social media as fact, but people report what they see, what they hear, what they smell, what they feel. And it involves, first of all, determining, okay, what are our search parameters? What are we going to search for monitoring this situation, this emergency as it unfolds? For instance, what hashtags are we going to monitor? What keywords are going to be triggers for us where we want to pay attention to? And it also involves setting up your monitoring streams somehow. And that might be just a Twitter feed. It might be a tweet chat program I've used in the past. It might be a Listly or something like that, where you're setting up the feeds for those hashtags or for those keywords. This is a screenshot from an interesting program I found. I believe it's called Geofedia. Don't quote me on that, but check it out. And it's a way of geographically understanding where these are occurring, which is very, very important. Yeah. Oh, she did. Okay. Right on. Well, I just want to show you one last clip, because speaking of emergency preparedness, this is one of my favorite examples of getting creative with emergency management messages. I'm not sure how many of you have seen this before, but a couple of emergency managers got together. This is Tanya Ferraro and Keith Dowler, and they were trying to figure out a way to have fun with social media and to get people to understand what to put in their emergency kit, right? These are messages that we hear all the time. What do you put in your emergency kit? You're supposed to make a kit, have a plan, and be prepared. So what's in your kit? Flashlights, things like that. But that's boring. Nobody actually makes their kit. So what they did was they put together this little parody of the Royals song, and they put it together in the morning, sang it to their webcam, and this thing has thousands of views. I'm just going to show you a little clip.
And I hunker down, no shelter and feed, cause then my kids like flashlight, duct tape, whistle like a bow on band-aid, first aid, extra medication, we don't care. We're gonna shelter for days on three. And my family's like candles, bring in all the pets, please. Food and water, gallon,
I'll leave it at that for now. Thank you. You can find me at governmentsocialmedia.com or check out my GovGirl videos, and I appreciate it. I will let the other speaker come up here.